So I could talk to you about computational public safety. I'm a prof at a university, so I teach in computer science. I could do that, in which case half of you would be upset. The other half would not be awake enough to be upset. So as I said, I'm Alex. Nobody knows how to pronounce the name. I spent 14 years in the Army. No one ever pronounced it right. Ferworn. So should we go to Plan B? Plan B is not talking about computational public safety. It's talking about something else. Hit it, boys.
The life I lead is an eye of a dog. I may have fleas, but I run a yard. I see those clones looking down on me, but unlike those clones, this dog is free.
Oh Lord, it's a dog's life. Oh Lord, it's a dog's life. Dog's life. Oh Lord, it's a dog's life.
All right, so instead I'm going to talk about dogs. And I'm going to talk a little bit about robots. Those robots that you see lying around, they're flying around and sometimes poking you in the butt. They're mine, and my students are back there. We have a place called the Network-Centric Applied Research Team. Badly named, because we don't do anything with networks at all. But we do a lot with dogs and robots, and it just happens we fell into this area called disasters. Anybody know what a disaster is? I don't mean your iPhone's out of energy. Disasters. One more. That's a disaster. So large disruptions, human, material, economic, environment, bad stuff happens. You may notice the Philippines is experiencing such a thing, and it's happened in the past. Those of you who remember Haiti in 2010, another one that happened a little further in our past. Really, the characteristic that you're interested in is the capacity of the local first response is used up. So there's no way you can deal with it with local resources. So you need external resources. And this is not a bad thing, but you do need to recognize that point. So this is not like your treehouse caught fire and the firemen come and they put it out and it's all good. This is like the whole city catches fire and it's the zombie apocalypse and it's very bad. So the immediate response is normally, this is what happens directly after. So our research is mostly about response, right? So what you do about this stuff when it happens to you. So R is a search and rescue thing. So the search and rescue is as it sounds. People search for you, and then they try and rescue you. There is a specialized case of this. So inside this is all manner of disaster that can happen, all horrible things that can befall you. But there's one that's particularly bad. So what you just saw there was something called a structural collapse. It was a deliberate structural collapse. Engineers go in, they put explosives around the structural components of the building, and they deliberately set it off. And this is not a bad thing when you get lots of people out warning, people move out, it's all okay. It's not quite so good when it happens to you. And structural collapses are sort of the hidden menace of disasters. Next slide. Structural collapses. They happen all the time. We just don't notice them because they don't happen to us, right? So all these places, Taiwan, Haiti was a particularly interesting one for us. We almost sent first responders from Canada, but oh, we didn't quite do it. This is a huge problem. The United States, they're actually used to responding to this type of disaster. We're not, because look around. You live on a giant rock, right? So not a lot of stuff happens here, except it happened here. Who would have thought that Elliott Lake would have a disaster? Who would have thought Elliott Lake would have a mall? But they had a mall, and it was horrible. And here is the problem.
As we watch this video, each minute that passes reminds us of the precious moments a person clings to when trapped alive under the rubble of a disaster. As they desperately wait for rescue, they listen for the sound of a search dog who will save their life.
So have a look, right? Look around you. Those of you who got here early to get good seats, come on, you did it. you're dead. If this place collapsed, you're toast. You're in the middle, right? So this is where the pancake tends to happen. Pancake is all this nice stuff up here that looks like it's keeping you dry. That's the source of your death. Look up. Say hello. This stuff comes down. It doesn't come down nicely. Actually, the smart people are the ones who arrive late because they got the cheap seats. The cheap seats are probably around the structural components of the building that might survive. So when that thing comes down, they're laughing at you. You're dead. My legs have been crushed, but you're dead. I can't get out. I'm in a void. I can't find anything. I can't move anywhere. And I've got about 48 hours until I'm dead. But until I'm dead, you're dead. So what finds you? Not magic technology. More than likely, it's going to be a search dog or a SAR dog in the case of in the woods. But they have a specialized dog called an USAR dog or urban search and rescue.
All right, pack bot going in.
Yeah, go ahead. Run that
in.
Thing.
Waterproof. Here we go. Taking a bath. And still functional. Uh-oh.
Like, that never really happened to a dog that I've ever seen. Right? Like, a dog doesn't generally run down, fall over, and then just not get up, right? But that happens all the time, right? I have dozens of hours of video of that exact thing happening, right? So what's been happening in the world is a kind of a replacement for the dog. This is not to say that the dogs work, right? They basically run up to the place. They do something called air scenting. Smell around. They find your scent. They run to where you are. And then they bark. That tells the handler, hey, that dog is interested in something that's under there, and that's you. So those guys, I'm not talking to you, you're dead. The live guys back there, that's what you want to hear, right? So the problem, of course, is, a little bit of the problem is, the dog kind of has to go away. So think about this. So you're the live ones, not the dead ones, but the live ones. The live ones, the dog's barking, you're so happy to see that dog. Oh, this dog's going to save my life. Then the dog leaves. How do you feel now? Even the dog won't stay, right? It's horrible. Okay, there are problems with dogs. Here's a problem with a dog. You have to listen carefully to this. So shut up and listen. See? Anybody hear it? It's very, very subtle. Anybody know what it is? I can't see any stupid lights. Anybody hear anything? Come on, take a shot at it. No, machines are fine. Machines are going to replace dogs. Anything else? Anybody else? Yes. Arrhythmic. No, you a mathematician or something? No. Nobody caught that. I can't believe you can't catch it. What language was the dog speaking? A speaking dog. Do you know dog? I don't know dog. So what do you think the dog was saying? The dog was saying, what do you think the dog was saying, first of all, given the situation? What do you think the dog was saying? I'm here. I found a survivor. No, that dog does not care about you. That dog gets rewarded with a toy. If it finds a human being that's alive under rubble and it starts to bark, it will have playtime with its handler. And I bet you it was thinking something, oh, this is going to be good. I did this thing. I don't care about you at all. This toy, I want this toy. So it's always dangerous to put your thoughts on top of a dog. However, there's one thing that we know. The dog was trying to talk to us, whatever that message is. So how come we don't listen to the dog? We developed several systems. We used to put cameras on dogs. Yeah, that's sort of the end result, so sorry about you dead guys. You live guys, that's you trapped. We used to put camera systems on dogs in the mistaken belief that dogs actually look in important places. Dogs are nose-centric, they're not eye-centric. So who owns a dog? What do they look at? Let me show you probably what you've seen. Oh. 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 they don't look at anything really important most of the time. So when we actually put a camera on a dog to look at where the dog looks like, everybody said this dog's not looking at anything, and so we consequently saw nothing. So this is actually a huge problem. Let's go back to that slide. So if we release a dog, the dog does its job. It actually finds you in the trapped area. The problem is the dog doesn't stay, right? So what if we change that? To put something on the dog, this happens to be called the canine-assisted robot deployment. Robots have good linger time. If you can make them small enough, they can be carried by the dog. The dog's barking triggers a release mechanism on a device. The robot falls off and stays there. So now you can recall the dog, and now we can monitor what's going on. We can have a microphone and actually talk to someone saying, don't worry about this dog running away. We're coming to get you. So that's the whole idea. Next slide.
The dog leaves the scene, so we want something that actually will stay behind. Robots have a good linger time, so they can stay around with the victim. They can continue to monitor what's happening at the site where the victim is found, there can be a line of communication established through the robot.
Ryerson's done a lot of training with Dare. Dare is just a very calm, very patient. Dare goes back to the kennel every day, and he says to his buddies, he says, how many Ryerson University students does it take to dress a dog?
Usually two, from my experience.
You know what, over the past 8 years, he's done so much that very well experienced, very methodical. Believe it or not, I mean, he just seems to know, the task that's at hand. You know what's amazing about this? You've got three live humans standing on the rubble pile. So he's going up to search for a buried subject, right? So when he goes up there, he doesn't know. How does he know that he's not going to find one of them, that he's going to find a person buried? That's how smart the dog is.
So, this is the target.
Alrighty.
Yep, let's see if you're down there for another 10 minutes, I would think. At the moment, Patrick is providing us a scent trail.
You ready, Jimmy?
Okay.
Come on there.
Dogs are able to easily detect this, and through a process called air scenting. So the dog will put its nose up in the air, and it will do a form of doggy calculus to determine what the best method of getting to this location is. Where the dog determines the highest concentration of scent is when it will start to bark. I think it went fairly well. We have a one complete end-to-end test.
What a good dog! What a good boy! Oh, what a good
dog. We have a one example of a dog carrying a robot with in the underdog sling, being carried up the rubble pile, and then victim found and released by the dog within 0 feet of the target. We have video of the entrance to where the victim is, sent back from the robot that was released by the dog, and the dog came back unharmed, so it was a good day. So the system is actually relatively simple to understand. Instead of trying to replace the dog, we do something called augmenting the dog. So the dog, actually, there's nothing, none of our systems do anything at all to improve the dog. The dog is a good dog. The dog does things very, very well. The dog actually is smarter than us in a lot of ways. The dog knows exactly when to release that pack. So why don't we listen to the dog? So we augment the dog to do a function which it does naturally. Are you hot? I'm hot. Is this like a hot? Who's hot? Next slide. Yes.
Oh,
So full disclosure, the dog didn't bark first. It was Jimmy Tran. Jimmy Tran, shake your hand there. We have a secondary release when the dog just doesn't cooperate. All right. So I'd just like to introduce Susan. She's a canine handler with Georgian Bay Volunteer Search and Rescue Organization. She's helping us here today with her dog, Azori. And so this is actually her. She's actually a school teacher. She's one of the four or five, I would say, it's debatable, canine civilian handlers. Most of your search and rescue needs are taken care of by the Ontario Provincial Police and local police establishments. But she takes incredible amount of time out of her life to make sure that stuff like this doesn't happen to you. Right? So thank you very much.